Melinda presents this unabridged recording of 44 Tiny Chefs, 44 Tiny Secrets, Book 3, written by Sylvia Bishop and read by Imogen Sage. The dedication reads, "For my excellent sisters, Jenny and Flo. Kiss, Sylvia Bishop." For Richard, with the warmest of ginger hearts, kiss, Ashley King. Chapter 1. The Trouble with Cakes. It was the first day of the spring holidays, and Betsy Beau Linnet was locked in a deadly battle with a chocolate eclair. The eclair had to be eaten. Her father Bertram had made it, and he was hovering next to her armchair in the parlour, looking hopeful and excited. But Betsy had already eaten profiteroles and raspberry turnovers and shoe buns and custard tarts and cream meringues and doughnuts and a lot of things that didn't even have names. But they all had plenty of sugar and cream. Everything had been delicious, but she had stopped enjoying herself about 10 cakes ago. About 8 cakes ago, her mother Bella had suddenly remembered some urgent piano practice she had to do. About 5 cakes ago, Grandad had suddenly remembered a nap he was meant to have. He was having it now, snoring loudly in his armchair to show how definitely asleep he was. "I think it's the closest I've got, Bee," said Bertram. "The trick was to double the cream."
"Oh," said Betsy faintly. "Right."
She picked up the eclair. 1 point to Betsy. The eclair oozed a slug of cream and glistened menacingly. She hesitated. 1 point to the eclair. From inside the piano, her mice squeaked encouragement. Betsy had 44 highly trained African pygmy mice, and they were very clever at a lot of things, including playing the piano. But they couldn't eat chocolate without being very ill, so there was no way they could help her now. Betsy took a deep breath. Then the phone rang, and Bertram went to get it. From the quiver in his voice, Betsy suspected it was his terrifying great-aunt Agatha, calling to remind him that he was due at hers for dinner tonight, as though he would ever forget. She quickly shoved the eclair in among an especially frondy fern. She would have to remember to get it later. She felt horrible about tricking him, and the horribleness ballooned when Bertram came back in and smiled at her empty plate. "Tasty?
Mmm, delicious,"
he beamed. "There are plenty more in the fridge." This was enormously true. The fridge was full to bursting. Bertram had stuck a sign on the door saying, "Help yourself to cakes." But then he had smeared some melted chocolate across the middle, so now it just said, "Help, splodge, cakes," which was about right. Bertram was already wondering out loud whether the extra cream trick would work with apple turnovers, and then he was off to the kitchen to try it. As soon as he had gone, Grandad woke up suspiciously quickly from his nap and gave Betsy a look.
"So," he said, "where did you put it, Bee?"
There was no point lying to Grandad.
"In the ferns. Grandad, has Dad gone mad?"
Grandad wagged his elbows thoughtfully, setting off a Mexican wave of bobbing and bowing among the ferns, then said,
"What makes you think he wasn't mad to start with?"
This was a fair point.
"Your dad," Grandad went on, "needs something to do. He's needed something to do ever since he gave up the piano. And it's been driving him quietly mad for a while. Now, he's found it. This is the sanest he's been for a long time. He's just got a bit overexcited, that's all.
Betsy thought about this. It made sense. Bertram used to be a pianist like Bella, but secretly he had been using his own pygmy mice to play for him. Just like Betsy's mice, there were 44, one for every two notes of the piano. Last summer he had come clean to Bella and the family about it, and once everything was out in the open, he had given the whole thing up. Now he mostly just did crosswords and ate cream cakes. It was nearly his birthday, and for weeks he had been planning the massive cream cake he would order for the occasion. When the bakery down the road had shut down and the best cream cakes in town were no more, he had gone to bed for two whole days. Then he had started baking. He was, it turned out, exceptionally good at it, and it really made him happy. In fact, he was the happiest Betsy had ever seen him. But the happiness depended on people wanting to eat his cakes.
"I don't think I can eat any more," said Betsy now. "We're going to have to stop pretending at some point, aren't we?"
"Oh, I don't know," said Grandad. "You could just keep feeding the ferns."
"Grandad, there are loads of ferns, but there aren't infinity ferns. And I think there might be infinity cakes."
And for a moment there was silence, as they both contemplated this fate. Grandad recovered from the thought first.
"I was only joking, Bee. You're right, of course. We just have to say it gently."
"Maybe we should start hinting now," said Betsy. "We can sort of lead up to it."
"Excellent idea, Bee," said Grandad.
He said it in the special way that means, "It is an excellent idea which you should carry out because I am very comfy in this armchair." He looked as though another nap might come on very fast. So Betsy stood up, put a couple of mice in the curls of her hair for moral support, and headed for the kitchen. The kitchen was filled with a soft, sweet smell. Even though she was sick of cakes, Betsy thought the smell was wonderful. The mice agreed. Their noses trembled in awe. In the middle of all the lovely smell stood Bertram, looking sadly at the fridge. He took some cakes out. He replaced them with other cakes. He shook his head. Betsy coughed.
"Dad?"
"Oh, hello, Bee."
"You okay?"
"Yes, yes."
There was a pause.
"The fridge," he said, "is full."
He considered this.
"Do you think," he asked, "I've made too many cakes?"
"Oh, no,"
lied Betsy. He looked so forlorn that she abandoned her hinting mission without a second thought.
"But," said Bertram, "no one has been eating them, and now the fridge is full."
This was a very sensible argument. The blob of cream on the end of his nose was less sensible, but overall, he had a point.
"I'm just saving mine," Betsy heard herself say, "because I want to have them for dinner."
Bertram perked up with such speed that the blob of cream on his nose wibbled right off.
"Really? Really?"
said Betsy, while what she thought was, "Oh, help." Still, her father was happy again. And tonight he would be out for his monthly dinner with his terrifying great-aunt Agatha, so she would have a chance to get rid of a box or two, somehow. She would start the letting him down gently plan tomorrow, almost certainly. Bertram hated visiting terrifying great-aunt Agatha. Betsy didn't blame him. She had only met her great-aunt once, and she had no wish ever to repeat the experience. But when the hour approached, Bertram took off his apron with brave determination and left the sweet-smelling kitchen with the air of a soldier leaving for battle. As soon as he had gone, Bella's urgent piano practice was abruptly over. Grandad found a sudden burst of energy and got up from his armchair at last, and even the mice seemed relieved. Betsy brought their tank to the kitchen and fed them their evening pumpkin seeds. The humans weren't hungry at all, but Bella said they had to eat something that wasn't 95% cream, so they each had a token supper of 3 lettuce leaves and a bean. While they ate, Betsy told the others about her promise to eat cakes for dinner, and they all had a think about where to hide some. Bertram was sure to see them if they were just thrown in the bin. It was Bella who suggested taking some to the neighbours. "They might like a few each," she said. "After all, they are very good, in normal quantities." This was true. In fact, they were superb, and giving them away felt much better than throwing them away. "There's some greaseproof paper here somewhere," Bella went on, getting up from the table. The contents of the kitchen had all been spilled out onto the surfaces in the baking frenzy. She began the search through recipe books and piping bags and spatulas and rolling pins, provoking plumes of flour. "We can wrap the cakes in that, if I can ever find it. Let's see, who do we know in the road? There's the Fortescues and the Cartrees and the McAvoys. And the Joneses," said Betsy, "and the Angelis." And she helped her mother hunt down the greaseproof paper and recall neighbours, while Grandad quietly fed his unwanted bean to a mouse. Paper located, they wrapped up oozing parcels of cakes, Bella showing Betsy how to seal them with a smart twist of the paper. Then Betsy took them to the neighbours. Everyone was delighted. They thanked Betsy over and over again and smiled the free, happy smiles of people who have never had to eat more than 10 cream cakes in one day. So that was all right. In fact, it was almost nice. Betsy didn't feel too guilty about it, and when she went to bed that night, she drifted straight into untroubled sleep. The next morning, Betsy woke early, but when she came downstairs, Bertram was already in the kitchen, waiting for something in the oven to rise. He was looking wistfully at a copy of the London Natter. This was odd. Normal expressions when reading the London Natter are bored, very bored, painfully bored, or asleep.
"Morning, Dad. What are you reading about?"
He turned the Natter to show her. It was a full-page colour advert for something called the Mega Mix-O-Matic, which was apparently a must-have item for every baker. There was a photo, and it looked like a whole kitchen had been in a tragic accident. Spoons, whisks, knives, forks, and other less identifiable objects stuck out at all angles from a shiny silver cube. "It looks wonderful," said Bertram, "but it's a bit of a silly price." Betsy had £5 to spend on Bertram's birthday, which was in 4 days. Since he wasn't getting a giant cream cake anymore, maybe he could have a Mega Mix-O-Matic. She looked at the number below the picture. It was quite a lot more than £5. "So," said Bertram, "that's enough of that. Back to the baking. I see from the fridge that a certain someone had cakes for dinner. What do you fancy today, Bee?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.